Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Unnatural Ability, The History of Performance-Enhancing Drugs in Thoroughbred Racing, by Milton C. Toby. Narrated by Barry Abrams. Since the turf attained the dignity of a language of its own, there has never been coined a term which has attained the popularity than the one dope has achieved. Dope, an American term. New York Times, April 7, 1901. Age and treachery will overcome youth and skill. Attributed to professional cyclist and two-time Tour de France winner Fausto Coppi. Introduction. Deja vu all over again. The genesis of horse racing was most likely a boast and a challenge. My horse is faster than your horse. Probably with a neighborly wager to keep things interesting. The organized sport came later, and the horses had little in common with today's thoroughbreds. Over time, the impromptu matches evolved into race meetings, and jockey clubs emerged to oversee those meetings. What started as a sport would be transformed into a multi-billion-dollar business, with legal and illegal betting driving the game. The question of who has the fastest horse remains the quintessence of racing, while the meaning of my horse has expanded, becoming a more abstract concept with many moving parts. Today, the success or failure of a thoroughbred depends on the trainer, his or her assistants, the jockey, the farrier, a veterinarian or two, a nutritionist, the exercise riders and backstretch workers, the breeder, and the horse's pedigree. Wild cards in the mix, and there are many, include an unknown number of performance-enhancing drugs, PEDs. Increasingly, it seems, sports are defined by their doping scandals. This does not necessarily mean that the use of PEDs is on the rise, although that is probably true in some sports. In horse racing, it is impossible to know with certainty the extent of PED use. Extremely small numbers of positive test results are announced on a regular basis, but extrapolating a few test results to an entire sport is risky, and testing every horse in every race is far too expensive and time-consuming to be practical. These numbers do not take into account the widespread use of the medication Lasix. Questions remain whether Lasix is actually a performance enhancer, but far more horses are given Lasix than need it, suggesting that trainers think the drug provides some sort of an edge. Moreover, new PEDs are always being developed, which existing tests cannot detect. In the race between the developers, distributors, and users of new PEDs on the one side and the regulators on the other side, the latter are a step or two behind and always playing catch-up, because that is the nature of the doping game. The good news is that testing for prohibited medications is getting more accurate and sensitive, and the time gap between the development of a new PED and the ability to detect it is shrinking. It also matters that drug scandals in sports attract far more attention today than in the past, especially from casual fans, through television exposure, social media, and a voracious 24-hour news cycle. This increased visibility also fuels the perception that many sports have a drug problem, even if that is not the reality. Doping incidents have plagued horse racing for more than a century. The sport has been under scrutiny for PEDs since the late 1800s, even before there were reliable chemical tests for the drugs. The modern era of systematic doping began at outlaw tracks in New Jersey. Whether legal or not, gambling has always been the lifeblood of the sport, and regulators have a long history of trying and failing to create a so-called level playing field to keep bettors and other participants active in the game. Even without adding PEDs to the mix, the search for a level playing field is a misguided pursuit. Before the early 1930s, there were no reliable tests for prohibited substances in the United States. The introduction of doping on a systematic scale in the 1890s is attributed to the mysterious Doc Ring and his imitators. The widely publicized death of a thoroughbred named Dr. Riddle of an apparent drug overdose in 1903 was based largely on speculation. Backstretch raids and arrests by the Federal Bureau of Narcotics in the 1930s were reported in newspapers, and the federal criminal court records are contained in the National Archives in Chicago. The license of prominent trainer Silent Tom Smith, of Seabiscuit fame, was revoked for using the stimulant ephedrine in the 1940s. The massive appellate court record is archived in Albany, New York. The Smith litigation established that penalties could be levied without a positive drug test. Proof of a violation based on non-analytical evidence rather than laboratory evidence was later used by the U.S. Anti-Doping Agency in its successful case against bicyclist Lance Armstrong. Increased reliance on non-analytical evidence, investigation, and whistleblowers will be necessary when the delayed medication portion of the Horse Racing Integrity and Safety Act of 2020, HISA, becomes operational. Kentucky Derby winner Dancer's Image was disqualified after a controversial positive test for a prohibited medication in 1968, followed by years of litigation. Congressional hearings were held in the 1970s that attempted to link the sport to organized crime and fixed races. And amazingly, after half a century of debate about whether Lasix is a PED that should be prohibited on race day, the question remains unresolved. More recently, there was a Derby winner on steroids in 2008. Growing threats are posed by designer drugs, blood doping, and gene doping. There was a string of federal indictments of trainers, veterinarians, and drug suppliers in 2020. To cap things off, when 2021 Kentucky Derby winner Medina Spirit tested positive for a prohibited medication, it set off a media frenzy and ultimately resulted in disqualification of the Derby winner. It's deja vu all over again, as Yogi Berra might say. Followers of racing could add, and again, and again, and again, to Berra's observation. Distressing as these events appear when taken individually, there is a more important dilemma facing thoroughbred racing today. Are the bad actors simply outliers in an otherwise clean sport, as many regulatory authorities and die-hard racing fans argue? Or are they players in a long-running pattern of doping culture? Are they the tip of a doping iceberg that no one wants to recognize? It is a critical question as racing faces new challenges and competition from legal sports betting outside Nevada. The U.S. Supreme Court decision that overturned the Professional and Amateur Sports Protection Act cleared the way for individual states to authorize sports betting. A number of states moved quickly to do so, and sports betting legislation is pending in other jurisdictions. Horse racing is no longer the only legal bet in town. Even with state support propping up racing in some places, integrity is vital if the sport is going to survive. Integrity is also elusive. During the 1940s, racing vied with professional baseball for the top spot among spectator sports in America. Baseball attendance totaled approximately 10 million fans in 1940, less than 9 million midway through World War II, when many star athletes served in the military, and 11 million in 1945. In contrast, attendance at the country's racetracks increased throughout the war years, from 8.5 million in 1940 to 18 million in 1944. Today, racing seldom makes the top 10 on attendance lists, and sometimes not even the top 20. Bennett Liebman is head of the Government Law Center at Albany Law School, a former New York State Racing and Wagering Board member, and a prolific writer about legal issues in thoroughbred racing. He identified more than a dozen reasons for horse racing's precipitous decline in popularity for the New York Times. The integrity-related issues relevant to doping included the following: corruption and the inability to prevent it. The perception that the sport is not being conducted on a fair level has harmed racing greatly and almost destroyed the sport of harness racing. When there were no other forms of legal gambling, the sport could get by with the odor of corruption. But with faster and more honest gambling venues now at hand, before the spread of sports betting, the sport cannot tolerate corruption. Drugs. The sport has not been able to prevent the use of drugs, and the belief that many of the sport's leading trainers have regularly chemically enhanced the performance of their horses. We have never been able to explain or explain away the Oscar Barrera phenomenon, where one trainer in New York in the late 1970s and early 1980s seemed to be able to improve a horse's performance magically overnight. Public perception. Corruption and drugs, plus the use of whips on horses and the catastrophic injuries we have seen in major races, have contributed to the perception that horse racing is a cruel sport which has little concern for the health or safety of the horse. Liebman made these observations more than a decade ago, but he could have written them yesterday. The dilemma facing horse racing today is clear. How can we identify a nebulous culture of doping? A related question: are PEDs a genuine problem to be addressed by regulators, or simply a public relations concern to be managed? Regulators argue that it is the former, but a fractured web of governance by state racing commissions and inaction by legislators has hampered efforts to control PEDs, sometimes leaving bettors and fans with the impression that managing expectations about doping may be the best that racing can manage. Finally, though, there is light at the end of the tunnel with the passage of HISA in 2020. The law's objectives include uniform national rules for medication and safety, correcting a hit-or-miss state-by-state regulatory scheme that has always made it difficult to control the use of PEDs. The legislation received staunch support from the Jockey Club and most stakeholders, but was challenged in court by a few prominent national and regional industry groups, creating a divisive split over medication control. A decade ago, journalist Claudio Gatti asked Jörg Jaksche, a retired professional bicycle racer from Germany, about doping culture in sports. "Each new doping scandal follows the same pattern," Jaksche told Gatti. "When someone is caught, the system acts shocked and upset, declares its absolute rejection of doping, and depicts the athlete as a black sheep that deserves to be slaughtered. After that, everything continues like before. But the fact is that they slaughter a scapegoat, not a black sheep, and no one ever looks at the shepherd's responsibility. I'm talking about those in the higher levels, those who govern the sports, and most importantly, those who provide the money that fuels everything." In a subsequent recorded interview, Jaksche expanded on his thoughts about how a doping culture can take over a sport, in his case, professional cycling. "It's a vicious circle," Jaksche said. "It's like a domino effect. I think in economics it's called prisoner dilemma. This is a situation where you actually don't know what the other party does, and by prior experience about what happened in the past, you assume that the other party is cheating, so you have to cheat as well. At the end, there is an equilibrium where everyone is cheating. That's what's happening in cycling, at least in my time." Jaksche's analysis of doping culture works well for professional bicycle racing, which has been addicted to PEDs since the 1890s, when riders competing in grueling six-day races needed a chemical boost not to win, but just to survive the ordeal. It is not a perfect fit for thoroughbred racing, particularly when it comes to direct involvement, or at least a blind eye, at the highest levels. There is no indication that racing is facing a government-sponsored doping conspiracy as occurred in Russia during the 1990s and East Germany in the 1970s. Nor is there evidence of doping at the sport's institutional level, although comparison of a trainer's stable with Lance Armstrong's professional cycling team might be a better fit. Sadly, however, Jaksche's pattern of doping scandals at the individual level in racing is familiar enough to raise anxiety in anyone who follows the sport. History creates a context for the present and informs the future. Much has been written about the development of PEDs and the philosophy and ethics of doping in human athletics. The subject of doping in horse racing has received far less attention. My goal here is to provide the first comprehensive history of PEDs in racing told from multiple perspectives: historian, journalist, and more often than not, detective. It is a distressing narrative for anyone who loves thoroughbred racing, but a necessary story to tell. To better understand where racing's war on drugs is going, and to answer the nagging question of whether there is a doping culture in the sport, it is essential to know where we've been and how we got here. Part 1. The Man Who Made Them Run. 1. The Death of Dr. Riddle. The horse lay dead in his stall, the apparent victim of a massive dose of cocaine, heroin, arsenic, strychnine, or some combination of drugs and patent medicines intended to make a horse run faster. Instead, on an afternoon in May 1903 at Morris Park in the Bronx, dope killed a horse named Dr. Riddle. There was nothing special about Dr. Riddle. He was a 6-year-old son of Iroquois, the first American bred to win the Epsom Derby in 1881, racing for Pierre Lorillard IV. But Dr. Riddle had inherited little of his sire's ability. Instead, by 1903, he was racing mainly in selling races for smaller purses. The winner of a selling race, a forerunner of the modern claiming race, would be put up for auction, with the listed selling price as the opening bid. The weight a horse carried in the race depended on the owner's selling price. The lower the selling price, the lower the weight. The owner could bid on his own horse, but ran the risk of paying more than the horse was worth to keep. Like today's claiming races, the idea behind selling races was to create an incentive for owners to run horses in races where they would face similar competition. With all the horses in the field presumed to be of more or less equal ability, selling races presented more exciting and presumably more honest contests and betting. That was the theory, at least. In reality, an owner could easily manipulate the outcomes of a series of races to create more lucrative wagering opportunities. One way was to instruct a rider not to ride to win in certain races, but to try harder in others. Another tactic was to run a horse either doped or clean, depending on the desired outcome. Juggling drugs was the genesis of the phrase running hot or running cold, depending on whether a horse was doped for a particular race. Some unscrupulous owners and trainers would hop the horses in some races and in other races would not administer the drug. W.C. Vreeland, longtime turf rider for the Brooklyn Daily Eagle, explained. Hence the beginning of the phrase, hot and cold. The horse, when stimulated with the drug, showed its effect by sweating profusely. He was all steamed up. When not touched up with the drug, his coat was dry, and he walked and raced in listless fashion. He was cold. He had become an addict. The practice of using performance-enhancing drugs to produce convenient improvements in a horse's racing ability sometimes had unexpected consequences. Reporting on the races in New Orleans in late 1892, a writer for the New York Times recalled an incident involving a track official who ordered that a horse named India Rubber be injected before a race, yet the horse was beaten. The apparent intent of the order was for India Rubber to run hot with his usual dose of drugs, cocaine, morphine, or whatever the stuff that is used, instead of cold, so that bettors would get a payoff. The plan backfired, though, when it was learned that the horse had been injected with only water. It is the easiest thing to run a plater cold for 4 or 5 races until the price on him is around 20 or 30 to 1 and load him up with go powders and turn him loose, sports writer turned novelist Paul Gallico explained. Another cheerful variation is to run a horse hot 5 or 6 times, tip him to win, turn him out cold, and hold the bets off on him. There is no way to know whether Dr. Riddle was one of those horses typically running hot or cold at his owner's and trainer's discretion. The horse's performance in the month preceding the second race at Morris Park on the day he died raised the question, however. On April 1, 1903, competing in a 6-furlong selling race at the New Memphis Jockey Club track in Tennessee, Dr. Riddle was an also-ran. Scorpio won the race at odds of 60 to 1. 9 days later, in a 1-mile selling race in Memphis, Dr. Riddle took the lead midway through the race and won by 2 lengths. The betting on Dr. Riddle that day opened at 4 to 1, but he started as the 8-5 favorite, an unlikely drop in odds for a horse that had been unplaced a few days earlier. On May 3rd in Jamaica, New York, Dr. Riddle started as the favorite in a 1-mile 70-yard race, but did not place. Odds on the winner, Past, opened at 10-1, but closed at 6-1 after heavy betting. On May 15th at Morris Park, the winner in Dr. Riddle's final race was Miss Buttermilk, a 40-1 long shot. There are legitimate reasons for Dr. Riddle's uneven races leading up to Morris Park, but speculation hinted at a horse running hotter than planned and a betting scheme gone terribly wrong. Although race fixing was never proved and specific drugs were not identified, the press took the suppositions of betting chicanery and doping as fact, with sensational headlines sometimes laced with grim irony. Did dope kill horse racing? Big killing planned on Dr. Riddle at Morris Park went wrong. Doped for a killing. Doping of Dr. Riddle was apparent to all. Looked like case of hops. Doped racehorse dies. A scandal of the turf. Dr. Riddle doped, resulting in his death. Headlines aside, there was no real proof that Dr. Riddle was doped with a particular drug before the race, nor was there any conclusive evidence that the horse had been doped at all. A reliable chemical test to detect drugs in a horse's system was still decades away in the United States, so the lack of hard and fast evidence was no surprise. The conventional wisdom at the time was that the only way to identify a doped horse before a race was through close observation. The experts said that a veterinarian, and presumably an experienced layperson, could almost always pick out a drugged horse by examining the animal's eyes. Excessive sweating and erratic behavior were other indicators of a doped horse. As soon as the drug begins to act, according to one account, the horse breaks into a sweat. The least walking exercise will cause the animal to lather as if he had been raced 2 miles at top speed on a hot day. His eyes begin to look unnaturally brilliant, and he becomes nervous and sometimes savage. He is anxious to run everywhere and anywhere, and can scarcely be restrained from running away while going to the post. Such cases are dangerous to the life of the jockey, for the horse is just as likely to run into the fence as he is to run straight. There were no published reports of any examination of Dr. Riddle's eyes that might have indicated doping. Before the race, he was already out of control in the paddock. The horse went into convulsions shortly after returning to the barn and was dying when the stewards sent a veterinarian to check on him. Dr. Riddle's decidedly abnormal behavior certainly fit the physical criteria for an artificially stimulated horse, however, and left little doubt in anyone's mind that he had been doped. It was one of the most flagrant cases of doping that ever came to the notice of racing men, according to one newspaper account. Dr. Riddle was so thoroughly saturated with some kind of juice in the second race yesterday that it was apparent to the veriest novice. So high in spirits was the old son of Iroquois that his head fairly touched the clouds. Dr. Riddle was only one of several horses in the race suspected of having artificial stimulant under their hides, but he stood out from the others in the paddock because he acted like a crazy horse. His grooms could barely control Dr. Riddle while he was being saddled, and it was obvious that the horse presented a risk to the other horses, riders, and just about everyone around him. According to another report, the most exciting and dangerous event of the day was the crazy actions of the horse Dr. Riddle while in the paddock previous to going to the post for the second race. The man in charge of him had a hard time of it trying to hold him. At times, he walked around the paddock with his eyeballs distended and the perspiration running off him. He would rear, carrying the man off his feet and swinging him around as if he had no more strength than a child. At one time, so unmanageable did the animal become that it was almost impossible to hold him, and he knocked down a well-known Brooklynite and came very near injuring other people who were doing their utmost to keep out of his way. The unidentified writer concluded that the general belief was that Dr. Riddle had been overdosed with a stimulating drug. Intentional or not, the implication of that statement was that a normal dose of drugs would not have been out of the ordinary on a typical day of racing. The paddock judge, who isn't named in the newspaper accounts, should have called the bizarre situation to the Morris Park steward's attention, but chose not to do so. It was a questionable decision with no apparent explanation. His non-action lends some credence to the rumors of an insider's betting coup that would have required Dr. Riddle to race and win for the anticipated big payoff. Dr. Riddle staggered through the post parade like an inebriate on the Bowery, sweating and bumping into the rail. The starter, a gentleman named Fitzgerald, was more conscientious about his job than his colleague in the paddock. He alerted the stewards and asked for instructions. Under these peculiar circumstances, he wanted to know, should Dr. Riddle be allowed to start the race? This was a more complicated question than it might seem, as the answer involved the economics of operating a racetrack, rather than merely concern for horse and rider safety. If Dr. Riddle had been scratched from the race, disgruntled bettors almost certainly would have demanded refunds for their worthless bets. Those refunds would have been due from the New York Jockey Club, which operated paramutual machines at the track, and from bookmakers, whose presence at Morris Park was tolerated by management. But if Dr. Riddle were allowed to start the race, it could be argued that bettors at least got a run for their money, albeit a dubious one, since the horse had no real chance of winning. No refunds were required if a horse started a race but finished unplaced. Defining a starter for betting purposes was the source of some confusion at the time. Under the rules in effect during the early 1890s, Dr. Riddle would not have been considered a starter until he was under the control of the official charged with actually raising the barrier, Fitzgerald in this case. The Board of Control, which ran racing in New York for a few years, adopted a more permissive rule in 1893 that favored bookmakers at the expense of bettors. Under the new guidance, a horse became a starter for betting purposes as soon as the names of the horse and jockey were posted publicly on the official telegraph board at the track, even if the horse never made it to the starting gate. The purpose was to eliminate the need for bookmakers to create a so-called new book after a change in the field for a race. Bettors who waged on a starter that didn't make it to the post had no recourse. Technically, Dr. Riddle would have been an official starter in his final race under either rule. The stewards advised Fitzgerald to let Dr. Riddle break from the barrier with the rest of the field. However, they also instructed Fitzgerald to tell the jockey, Oscar Solling, that he had permission to pull up and not risk injury. Solling did as he was instructed, probably relieved that he didn't have to try to win. Solling very pluckily broke away from the post, but at once pulled up the horse, which was reeling under him, and walked to the stretch long after Miss Buttermilk, a 40-to-1 long shot which raced out in front with Kickshaw all the way, had won the race by a head. Dr. Riddle had become so uncontrollable by then that Solling could not maneuver him back to the paddock. The rider gave up, dismounted in front of the grandstand, and turned the horse over to two grooms. Finally, and with much effort, the grooms managed to get Dr. Riddle back to the barn. The horse was so fractious, though, that he could not be cooled down as usual, so the grooms put him back in his stall. Dr. Riddle suffered convulsions and died about 2 hours after the race. The Daily Racing Form simply noted that Dr. Riddle got off poorly. The track stewards originally wanted to have a veterinarian examine Dr. Riddle in the paddock immediately following the race. But after watching the rider try and fail to get the horse to the paddock, the plan changed. The veterinarian was dispatched to the stable area to examine the horse sometime later. After reviewing the veterinarian's report, which was not made public, the stewards issued this ruling. The stewards of the meeting order that the entries of Jay Gardner and the horse Dr. Riddle be refused and the license of trainer William Howell be suspended. The reference to Dr. Riddle racing again became moot, of course, with the horse's death. Any further sanctions imposed on owner John Gardner and trainer Howell would be at the discretion of the Jockey Club. There was some disagreement in published reports the next day about whether Gardner and Howell went to the barn to check on Dr. Riddle after the race, but they probably did not. There was little incentive to do so, considering their connection to the public debacle that had played out just a few minutes earlier. There were subsequent allegations that an unnamed groom employed by Howell had injected Dr. Riddle with 12 grains of cocaine before the race. The groom disappeared, however, and the report was never confirmed. Sometime later, Howell reportedly exonerated Gardner and took full responsibility for Dr. Riddle's condition and his subsequent death. A more plausible explanation was provided a few years later by John Bowden, a former secretary of the New York State Racing Association. According to Bowden's strange but almost certainly true account, two different groups of bettors were planning to back Dr. Riddle in the Morris Park race. Each group had a groom working in trainer Howell's barn, and the two grooms, unbeknownst to each other, both doped the horse. A week later, on May 22nd, trainer William Howell was ruled off the turf, presumably for life, by the stewards of the Jockey Club, August Belmont, James R. Keene, J.H. Bradford, F.R. Hitchcock, H.K. Knapp, and Andrew Miller. The stewards relied on Rule 162, which stated in part, "Any person who shall be proved to have affected the speed of a horse by the use of drugs internally, whether administered by hypodermic or any other method, shall be ruled off." The Jockey Club stewards employed a broad definition of proved in reaching their decision, as there was no chemical test and only circumstantial evidence to establish that Dr. Riddle had been doped. No action was taken against John Gardner, Dr. Riddle's owner. This was surprising, given his alleged involvement in a similar doping incident in Canada. The Canadian charge against Gardner was reported, but with few details, in at least one newspaper the day after Dr. Riddle's fateful race. Although it was relevant to Dr. Riddle's death, the information was apparently not provided to the Jockey Club. Dr. Riddle's well-publicized death attracted the attention of the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, ASPCA, which sent a badge-wielding and probably armed investigator to Morris Park with statutory authority to arrest animal abusers. One reporter suggested that there were better ways to deal with the doping problem. It looks, however, as though the society could better serve the purpose by assigning the task to a trained veterinary surgeon instead of to one who has merely done patrol duty. The idea of assigning a veterinarian to the paddock for every race at every track would resurface 3 decades later as one of several recommendations resulting from the short-lived war on illegal drugs at East Coast and Midwest racetracks waged by Federal Bureau of Narcotics Commissioner Harry J. Anslinger. Henry Berg, a playwright and animal lover who fortunately had a large inheritance to fall back on when his writing efforts failed, formed the ASPCA during the mid-1860s. He successfully lobbied the New York legislature to approve the country's first major anti-cruelty statute. The law also granted arrest powers to the ASPCA's agents, an unusual accommodation for a non-governmental entity. More than 150 years later, animal welfare and animal rights groups play a prominent and sometimes controversial but unofficial role in horse racing oversight. There is no record of anything substantive coming out of the ASPCA's investigation into Dr. Riddle's death. The mere presence of an investigator on the grounds of a racetrack was significant, however, because it demonstrated a new and expanding role for the animal welfare movement in the United States. It also illustrated a significant conflict for Berg and his agents when it came to horse racing. One of the ASPCA's primary goals was, and still is, to reduce, if not eliminate, cruelty to animals. The conflict arose because many of the wealthy owners racing their horses at New York tracks were Berg's friends. They were also financial and political supporters of much of the ASPCA's work, but only so long as Berg did not interfere with horse racing, fox hunting, pigeon shooting, or their other favorite sporting pastimes. Berg acknowledged the ASPCA's problems related to horse racing shortly after the organization was formed. Biographer Zulma Steele quotes him. "It is not my present purpose to protest against horse racing," he said, for it is an illegal sport sanctioned by all classes of society. Although Berg himself was welcome among the upper echelons of society and was reluctant to incur their displeasure at his perceived meddling, he eventually decided to investigate racing, despite his friendship with many of the owners. Cooperation with ASPCA investigators was expected from racing officials and was usually provided, though sometimes grudgingly, but things did not always work out as planned. Before a race at Jerome Park in October 1884, the ASPCA was informed that a horse named Jim McGowan was entered despite having a sore back. Agent Evans, no first name provided in the records, went to the track, investigated, and found no problem. He reported that the saddle was sufficiently padded to protect the horse's back. Before Evans could leave the grounds, however, he was approached by two prominent members of the American Jockey Club, which operated Jerome Park. Depending on which version of the story one believes, Judge A.C. Monson and David Withers either peacefully escorted Evans off the grounds, they are telling, or assaulted him, Berg's allegations. There was conflicting testimony at the subsequent trial. Some witnesses supported the account of the American Jockey Club members, while others told a different story. There was a large crowd surrounding Evans, Police Inspector George W. Ditka recalled, and they were shouting, "Hang him! Shoot him! Put him out!" According to the inspector, as Judge Monson and Matthew Sharp, who was apparently not charged, pushed him, Evans, under the rail, I caught him in my arms and told the crowd to stop. Evans said to me that he had paid his way in and remarked that they had treated him pretty roughly. I saw that his clothes were badly torn. There was also some question about whether Evans had properly flashed his badge. The charges against Withers were dismissed because there was no evidence that he had laid a hand on Evans. Charges against Monson were also dismissed on the basis of his testimony that he had used no violence when escorting Evans off the grounds. Press coverage of Dr. Riddle's death was extensive, even beyond New York. That lasted a few days, but interest quickly faded. After all, Dr. Riddle was an outlier in a sport where doping was presumed to be commonplace, but doped horses seldom died. Reporters covering horse racing generally paid more attention to gambling's supposed evils, ongoing reform efforts, and the political machinations of racing's friends and foes than to rumors of doping. It is impossible to know the true scope of performance-enhancing drugs in thoroughbred racing from the gay 90s through the first decades of the 20th century. One way to estimate the prevalence of such drugs would be to talk to someone who used them, and that's what reporter Bob McGarry did in 1932. He asked an expert. Peter Christian Barry, Patty to his friends, acquaintances, clients, and the authorities who chased him for decades on both sides of the Atlantic, was best known as a painter of horses. In other words, he had an uncommon talent for making one horse look like another, a skill essential for passing good horses off as bad ones, ringers, to win a bet at long odds. From November 21st to December 3rd, 1932, the New York Daily News published a 12-part series based on McGarry's meetings with Barry. The reporter and the scoundrel mostly talked about Barry's successes and failures with ringers, but Barry also discussed dope. "I would say without hesitation," Barry claimed, "that fully 60% of the horses racing on the American turf are stimulated. On many race courses, the stewards, if they see any inconsistencies in a horse's racing, will call you before them and advise you that you will not be permitted to run your horse hot one day, doped, and cold, au naturel, the next. You must either run him always cold or always hot, or be warned off. Hopping of horses is condoned." It's fair to be skeptical of Barry. He was a cheater and a liar who had a habit of peddling his life story to the press whenever he ran out of money, which was often. And a sensational story always sells better than a dull one. Barry was broke and on the run from the authorities when he talked with McGarry, but his comments have a ring of truth. A fundamental change in the use of performance-enhancing drugs was occurring as the Gilded Age was winding down. a practice once marked by occasional transgressions from a few bad actors at obscure racetracks, was becoming a widespread pattern of cheating that would threaten the integrity and ultimately the future of horse racing. This paradigm shift, and the first equine fatality in the modern era of doping, was a legacy that began with an outlaw track in New Jersey and a shadowy figure named Doc Ring. 2. Doc Ring and the Modern Era of Doping. The loneliest man in horse racing, and maybe in the entire world, during the winter of 1892 was the snowman at the Gutenberg racetrack. Night after night he scanned the sky over the New Jersey Palisades, watching for the blizzard that might be coming and sounding the alarm at the first sign of snow. A contemporaneous account of a typical night for the snowman at the Goot appeared in the Lewiston, Maine Evening Journal. Well muffled up against the biting winter winds, with an old fur hat pulled down over his ears and a quid of tobacco in his mouth, there marches back and forth in front of a great deserted building throughout the long hours of the night an individual whose vigil is perhaps the most curious ever imposed upon any watchman on land or sea. He carries neither lantern nor club, and his frequent observations of the heavens, together with his total indifference to his immediate surroundings, show conclusively that he apprehends danger only from above. He is engaged in a sleepless and careful watch of nothing under the heavens, but of the heavens themselves. If the night passes by with nothing more threatening than a few dark clouds and a little drizzle, he continues his quiet pacing to and fro. Let those clouds, however, drop the first few flakes of an approaching snowstorm, and on the instant this watchman, like a sentinel alarmed, is all activity. At his prompt summons, there issue from unexpected quarters detachments of men armed with shovels, who, as the snow thickens on the ground, industriously shovel it away. It is no uncommon thing for 50 men aroused from their beds at midnight by this watchman of the weather to fight the falling snow incessantly until long after daylight, or until it ceases. The snowman and his shovel brigade, identified in one report as a small army of Italians, were necessary because racing at Gutenberg continued unabated throughout the dreary winter, regardless of how foul the weather might be. Writing under the byline Audax Minor, G.F.T. Ryle covered thoroughbred racing for the New Yorker for more than half a century. When a sudden blizzard closed Pimlico Racecourse late in 1957, Ryle wrote about the cold weather experiment at Gutenberg. The Pimlico snowstorm gave the old stagers who were always grumbling that the younger generation is a bunch of softies an opportunity to recall their days in the 90s at Gutenberg, a New Jersey track just across the river from 72nd Street that used to run all winter. It was a sort of open-air horse room where you could also bet on New Orleans and California tracks. No matter how hard it snowed at Gutenberg, and there were blizzards in those days, a crew merely shoveled a wide path round the track for the horses, and the races went off as scheduled. Winter racing at Gutenberg was unique, at least in the northern states, where the season brought snow and freezing temperatures. Regular winter racing outside of warm weather venues would not become popular for decades. Even on the rare occasion when racing was canceled at Gutenberg, supposedly because of bad weather, there was usually another reason. According to management, on January 20, 1892, races were called off because the track was unfit to race over. While it might have been true that the racing surface was worse than usual that day, bad tracks were a familiar occurrence at Gutenberg in the winter, and treacherous conditions typically did not lead to the cancellation of racing. The excuse fooled none of the mob that patronizes the track, the New York Times reported, for they know that no track is too bad to prevent the Hudson County Jockey Club from racing over it. The track was in a horrible condition, but the real reason was said to be an order received from McLaughlin not to race until his return from Trenton, for fear of interference from the Law and Order League and the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. Dennis McLaughlin was one of the Big Four, along with Gottfried Walbaum, Nicholas Susius, and John C. Carr, who operated the Gutenberg track. Boss McLaughlin was in Trenton seeking Governor Leon Abbott's help with the worrisome and growing number of arrests on the Gutenberg grounds. Arrests were a persistent inconvenience of the racetrack, but the interruptions were tolerated as window dressing to assuage the Law and Order League and other anti-gambling reformers that wanted to close it down. In reality, the powerful Democratic political machine in Hudson County provided legal protection for the track operators, bookmakers, and patrons, extending from the local authorities up the chain of command to the state police chief. To get the bookmakers back to work as quickly as possible after the inevitable arrests, a local justice of the peace set up a makeshift court in a vacant stall on the back stretch, where he granted speedy releases on bail. With little competition from across the Hudson River in New York, Gutenberg's winter racing experiment proved immensely profitable for track owners, bookmakers, and betting shop operators. It was less popular with the Board of Control, a consortium of local jockey clubs that promoted the business interests of the elite racetracks in New York. The board also hoped to standardize the rules of racing in New York and later across the country, but failed to achieve this ambitious goal. Despite its brutal winter schedule, races for underdeveloped two-year-olds started on January 1st, the official birthday for all thoroughbreds, no matter when they were born, and a general disregard for the norms established across the river in New York, Gutenberg was the antithesis of an elite racetrack. Late in 1891, the Board of Control took action against the operators of Gutenberg with a resolution that banned owners, trainers, and horses competing during the winter in New Jersey from racing in New York when the weather improved. The New York Times approved. The Times has repeatedly advocated the passage of such an edict as has been formulated because the racing of horses in this climate in winter, and particularly the racing of youngsters as soon as they are for racing classification purposes 2 years old, is nothing more nor less than absolute cruelty. There is not a thing to be said in favor of racing in midwinter except that it gives people who want to gamble a chance to do so. The Big Four were not bothered by the Board of Control's ban, and winter racing and gambling continued as scheduled at Gutenberg. Legislation fully legitimizing horse racing in New Jersey, the Parker Acts, had strong support from the Democratic majority and was pushed through the State Assembly and House without hearings in early 1893. Still, the safe harbor for Gutenberg was short-lived. The first blow was a ban on winter racing passed in March 1893 as a concession to reformers. Republicans won majority in both houses of the legislature later that year. A state court ruled the Parker Acts unconstitutional in January 1894, and a few days later, the legislature repealed the pro-racing statutes. There was no racing in New Jersey for almost half a century. The Big Four were arrested a few days after the Parker Acts were repealed, based on the results of a police raid conducted 2 years earlier. They eventually pleaded guilty to keeping a disorderly house and operating the Gutenberg racetrack. Disorderly indeed. When a crooked jockey named McDermott was ruled off, prohibited from riding at Gutenberg in 1892, it surprised just about everyone, but for different reasons. A few people were shocked because the decision to ban McDermott had taken so long. The majority, though, were surprised that the Big Four allowed the ban to happen at all. McDermott's reputation as a cheat was well known. He had been involved in fixing races for McLaughlin and his friends, and most people assumed that he would be protected from any disciplinary action. Apparently, though, the jockey had held his mount back in a race he was supposed to win. This cost McLaughlin and his cronies a significant amount of money, and McDermott's protection vanished. Gutenberg was not the only disorderly house among the outlaw tracks operating in New Jersey. Between the fifth and sixth races on December 22, 1890 at Clifton, a fight broke out between a bookmaker named Carroll and an African-American horse owner named White. A special dispatch to the St. Louis Globe Democrat reported that Carroll refused to take White's bet on his horse, Cora Tanner, using insulting language and accompanying his words with a kick which rattled against White's ribs. White then grabbed Carroll and endeavored to pull him down from his perch on the betting box. Then one of Carroll's clerks struck White on the head with a bottle of whiskey, spilling blood and an appetizing aroma for the crowd that pressed toward the belligerents and threatened to make a free fight. Special policemen forced their way to the box and stopped the disturbance. The police escorted Carroll from the grounds after the races were over, presumably allowing the bookmaker to take wagers on the last races of the day. Gutenberg, though, stood out among the outlaws. It was a godforsaken place by most accounts, a den of bookmakers, criminals, crooked politicians, broken-down horses, thieving jockeys, and fixed races. For all these reasons, Gutenberg was also an ideal proving ground for a visitor from the western frontier, a vanishing part of America's heritage. He brought a revolutionary new way to make horses run faster, an injection that was legal, cheap, and not against the rules of racing. When tabulations from the 1890 U.S. Census were finally complete, Superintendent of the Census Robert P. Porter made a startling announcement. Up to and including 1880, the country had a frontier of settlement, but at present the unsettled area has been so broken into by isolated bodies of settlement that there can hardly be said to be a frontier line. In the discussion of its extent, its westward movement, etc., it cannot, therefore, any longer have a place in the census reports. For decades, the census had used the limits of Western migration as a significant measure of America's growth. Now, after more than a century of expansion, America's Western frontier was closed. Superintendent Porter's pronouncement did not suggest that a wall or some other physical barrier be erected on the Mississippi River's western bank, nor were there new government restrictions on travel. The closing of the frontier merely meant that an imaginary line beyond which there was still ample unexplored and unsettled land had reached the Pacific Ocean, making further westward advancement impossible. Without a moving line to monitor, the U.S. Census Bureau lost interest in defining the frontier. For much of the population, especially in the eastern United States, the second industrial revolution driving the country inexorably toward the 20th century was far more relevant than any romance offered by the frontier. The future, marked by unimagined advances in communication, transportation, medicine, and science, was calling. Even Colonel William Cody, Buffalo Bill, recognized as much. When Buffalo Bill offered his famous Wild West show to the organizers of the World's Columbian Exposition in Chicago in 1893, he was turned down because of incongruity. The exposition would showcase things that were new and exciting for the world to experience. To the fair's organizers, cowboys and Indians no longer fit the image of America. Shunned by the World's Fair, Buffalo Bill found a piece of property next door, set up shop there, and had the last laugh on the exposition's selection committee. Buffalo Bill's Wild West and Congress of Rough Riders of the World ran longer than the fair and was a rousing success. Progress was becoming the watchword for the country, though, and Buffalo Bill's interpretation of the West was beginning to resemble a romanticized anachronism. Census numbers and perceptions of a vanishing frontier aside, the West was still mostly wild during the late 1880s, a vast expanse with plenty of opportunity and risk for the taking. It was a time of settlers and prospectors, farmers and ranchers, lawmen and outlaws, the Oklahoma Land Rush, the Earps, Bat Masterson, and the OK Corral. Powering the expansion were horses, and where there were horses, there was racing. By one estimate, more than 300 racetracks were operating in the United States in 1897, many of them in the West. Horse racing and boxing were two of the most popular sports, primarily because of the propensity of men's desire to wager a bet on just about anything, explained Marshall Trimble, Arizona's official historian and vice president of the Wild West History Association. Wyatt Earp owned a racehorse named Dick Naylor during his time in Tombstone, and he owned several during the next 20 years or so. According to Trimble, there were some racetracks between Los Angeles and San Diego. They would have had horse racing in towns that held rodeos, such as Prescott, Tucson, Phoenix, Payson in Arizona, Cheyenne, Wyoming, Denver, Colorado. Tracks were usually located at the county fairgrounds. The first in Phoenix was in 1884. The current fair site opened in 1905. Ranches competed against each other on makeshift tracks. Where you have horses, there's going to be some wagering on who had the fastest horse. And where there is racing, there will be cheaters, swindlers, and con men. Early attempts at boosting racehorses' performance were crude and usually involved drenches, oral doses of whiskey, sherry, coffee, or some other home-mixed concoction administered before a race. Whiskey and the other ingredients of a drench were easy to come by, and the image of a frontier saloon will forever be etched in memory as one of the most iconic symbols of the Old West. Opium
den. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.